Hello, my name is Dr. Joanne Tippett from the University of Manchester. I'm going to talk about a hands-on kit for creative engagement called Ketso as a tool for participatory data gathering. The word Ketso means action in Lesotho, Southern Africa, where I invented the toolkit in the mid-90s whilst working in rural regeneration. I found that women didn't tend to speak in mixed gender groups, and I wanted to find a way to make sure I could hear everybody's voice. In this brief video, I will introduce Ketso, explain how and when in the research process the kit can be used, explore the advantages and disadvantages of participatory data gathering, discuss how Ketso can be adapted to be used in different research contexts, and introduce a tool for analyzing the data produced by Ketso. Ketso is a flexible tool for effective thinking that has been used in stakeholder engagement around the world. In research, it offers a tactile way to stimulate discussion and to capture data. It has been used in research ranging from workplace skills to climate change adaptation to teaching practice to refugee health and integration, with over 50 peer-reviewed articles and PhDs reflecting this practice. Each participant has a pen and leaves to capture their ideas, so everyone gets a say. Participants cluster their leaves on a felt workspace, taking in turns to build up a shared picture of their ideas. And the researcher is able to gather that data in the form of what people have written on the leaves, researcher observations, and notes, and, where appropriate, recordings of the discussions. Ketso can be used in focus groups with a small group of people discussing key issues with the researcher, and in workshops to gather data from a much larger group of people, from tens to hundreds. In interviews with just one or two participants, it can be used to elicit and order ideas around the key themes of the interview. Ketso can be used in the early stages of research to surface assumptions and key issues, to refine the focus of your research and develop research questions with stakeholders. It can also help develop links with those stakeholders and make it more likely that the research will be of practical use and that it will be used. For instance, here we're working with key stakeholders to scope an action research project into sustainability skills with Tesco. Here we're developing research questions around youth and leisure with young people. In the main data gathering phase, Ketso can be used as a means of gathering the primary data. This could be the main method, or it could be one of many. The workshops or the ways of using Ketso can be directly related to the research questions, or they can be around a topic of use to the participants, where the gathering data for the research questions is more tangential. Here, for example, members of a women's cooperative in Costa Rica are exploring climate change resilience as part of an international research project looking at information communication technology and resilience. In the later stages of research, Ketso can be used to test and refine the analysis. It can be used to explore the implications of research or practice, and even to help you structure your writing. This work, exploring the implications of the findings of a PhD in water management, working with the community in Peru, in and of itself led to a further journal article. There are many advantages of participatory data gathering. For instance, people learn from each other and they develop ideas together. This makes the research process useful to them. There are opportunities for social learning and for people to challenge their own perceptions. There's an opportunity for the researcher to clarify issues, to probe and ask questions during the process itself. It's also one of the few ways that you can work with people who are illiterate or not able to read and write very well. You can adapt the process to suit the participants that you're working with. It can save time. You can get more people's points of view gathered quite quickly. For instance, with Ketso, we have run workshops with up to 200 people at once. The results are relatively easy to understand and accessible to lay audiences and decision makers. You can often get useful brief quotes to illuminate your writing. There are some particular advantages to using Ketso in participatory data gathering. It makes sure you hear from everyone. All different perspectives are on the table and can be seen. The physical kit itself helps to focus the discussion. The participants help you structure the data, and there's a physical artifact that captures those ideas in the form of people's writings and where they put the leaves and how they have structured the information. It also allows you to gather data from very groups as well as small. The largest workshop I've run is with 200 people. But there are some disadvantages of participatory data gathering. It may be difficult for people to raise sensitive or difficult topics in a group. This could be political or personal issues. It can be hard to organize a time and place to get that many people together. You can mitigate this by trying to go to them when and where they meet, but it still requires organization. It can be harder to capture all of the data, especially from discussions. It can be difficult to record in a noisy room, for instance. The researcher does need to pay attention and take notes. It's not as easy to generalize as with quantitative data. You have to be careful what truth claims you make. And it requires some skill to analyze the data and draw out key themes. Of course, it can also be daunting for a researcher to run a workshop. Here is where Ketso comes in, because to an extent, the focus is off the researcher and on the kit, and the participants are led through the process through the physical form of the toolkit. The key to successful use of Ketso in research is to decide what your questions are and how best to elicit the data to answer the questions using the kit. There will be a way to adapt Ketso to ask questions in a way that helps both you meet your research needs and helps the participants, that helps you uncover deeper meanings and have a more engaging discussion with everyone. The pieces of the kit itself lead you through the process of planning your workshop. There's a centerpiece on the felt, which is like the trunk of the tree. That's where you write the focus. It's really important to be clear what the focus of your workshop is about, what the aims are, both to plan the workshop and to introduce it clearly to the participants. You ask a series of questions around the core focus, with participants writing their answers on the colored leaves, where each color is used for a different question. We suggest that you ask one type of question at a time, and a sequence of questions that works very well in many contexts is to start with what works, what's good in this situation, what could be done differently, what are the future possibilities, what are the challenges or barriers, and what are the ways of overcoming these challenges or barriers, possibly leading into next steps and action. Each of these stages typically lasts 10 to 15 minutes. And of course, you can adapt those questions to suit the research that you're doing. The felt also has branches that stem out from the center trunk. These are like themes to organize and structure the discussion, and you decide what the themes are. Here's an example of branches I've used to structure discussion around well-being, using a framework that was developed by the New Economics Foundation. Now, these branches can really help you get into the core of your research, and there are a lot of advantages of having some themes to help structure the discussion. They provide focus, and of course, a greater likelihood of covering all of the key themes. They provide a degree of structure, and a framework can spark more ideas. These ideas can then be explored and tested against that framework. It can help you explore your research questions with careful thought as to how to word the themes so that they relate to your research but are understandable to the participants themselves. It can be easier and quicker for groups to compare ideas between tables if you're working with more than one group, and hence to learn from each other and to synthesize their ideas. It's easier for you to synthesize ideas from several groups. This is especially important if you're running a series of workshops or you have a lot of people in the room developing ideas together. It can also take less time for people to get going with the discussion because they start to cluster their ideas very quickly instead of spending time developing themes and trying to work out how to organize their thinking. However, there can be advantages to having a much freer flow of discussion where people don't use branches and they just develop their themes from the beginning. It allows you to explore an idea with no preconceived framework. There may be more possibility for surprising emergent themes, and participants can feel more ownership of the themes. But these may not be shared amongst the whole group if there's more than one table. Of course, it's also quicker to prepare for a workshop because you don't actually have to write anything up. It's up to you to decide which way works best with your research, and what I recommend is that you try both and see how they work. We tend to find that using some very simple themes to help structure the discussion really helps with the flow. There are resources to help you plan workshops on the Ketso website, including sample workshop plans that you can download and adapt. When you're planning for your Ketso workshop, we suggest you follow a few very basic principles. In particular, we suggest you proceed through clear focus activities, asking different kinds of questions, one at a time in sequence, in order to look at the issue from a variety of different angles. We highly recommend that you start with a focus on the positive. what works, what's good about this, what do you like, rather than the problems. This both helps participants to be more creative often and to come up with ideas, and it sets up less of a power dynamic that you're the expert here with the solutions to the problems, but they actually have knowledge and assets and resources that they can share. It does help shift the power between researcher and participant. We also recommend that at each stage of a workshop, you allow time for participants to write their ideas down on their own before they share them onto the felt. And that's for every stage, this period of reflection, then sharing. We call it think, then share, then discuss. Really make sure that everybody's ideas get onto the table. Now, if you're working with people who are illiterate or who need a carer to help write, you can ask them to draw or work with their carer in pairs in order to develop the ideas before they share them. So you can adapt that process. Once you've finished a workshop, you need to capture that data. And we strongly recommend that you get a photographic record of the data before you move the felts, and especially before you rinse the leaves clean in water. There's a free bespoke spreadsheet for helping you analyze the data from Ketso workshops. This helps you to keep the structure inherent in the data in the form of the colors of the leaves, the different types of questions you've been asking, the way they're clustered around the branches, the way the participants themselves have structured that information, and how they've prioritized it using the icons to show what they think is important. You get to keep that data, but then you get to play with it. For instance, this felt shows data gathered from one of a series of interviews around participatory development in Ghana, which used a particular framework to structure the discussion. The series of interviews were then entered into the spreadsheet and analyzed. The spreadsheet helps you to synthesize and code the data. It allows you to sort the data by theme, which is especially useful when you're pulling together data from a series of workshops, so you can read all of the ideas around a particular theme at the same time. Such as in these workshops exploring rabies prevention in Tanzania, where several different workshops were synthesized together in the analysis. The spreadsheet allows you to produce charts that let you see patterns in the data. For instance, the distribution of different types of ideas across the predetermined themes, and indeed emerging themes from the participants. Here we see the relative distribution of ideas around the five ways to well-being used to structure a workshop with the police force, which produced a surprising insight that the one area that the police staff thought would have the most ideas around what works, what's going well, was being active. Whereas in fact, this actually had the least, and that prompted some real discussion around the fact that they weren't very active in their day-to-day work. The spreadsheet lets you do your own coding, so you can look for themes in the data. You can follow an inductive approach, allowing for emergent themes for the data, or you can test the data for fit against a conceptual framework, or you can do a combination of the above. Ketso is used in more than half of the universities in the UK, and it is possible that your university already has kits that you can use in your research. You can contact Ketso to find out if this is the case, and visit the website for further resources and information.